Next, we turn to one of America's most brilliant lyricists, Tariq Trotter, of the Roots, better known as Black Thought. The Grammy-winning artist has wowed audiences for decades with his live performance skills. Some music critics contend that he's one of the greatest rappers of all time. Now, Black Thought is out with a memoir examining a life that began with tragedy. Both his mother and father were murdered. The book is called The Upcycled Self, and he discusses it now with Hari Srinivasan.
Christian, thanks. Tariq Trotter, also known as Black Thought to most of us who have listened to him for so many years as part of the Roots. Thanks so much for joining us. First of all, congratulations on this book. I am not surprised that you're venturing out into this sort of written word expression. What does the upcycled self mean?
I'm from Philadelphia, from a specific place in time there, where you know you had to sort of move through life with a layer of callus, right? Of scar tissue, almost as a protective sort of thing. You know, and it serves a purpose at your one time in your life, or at least it may. And then as we evolve, as we, you know, mature, as we move on in life, these things no longer serve us in the same way. So the upcycled self, it speaks to, you know, the wisdom it takes to recognize when to, you know, leave a thing in the past, yeah. To adapt away or you know, to move forward in a different way.
You start out this book with something I suspect anybody would want to leave in the past. And it's a horrendous story of you setting your house on fire as a little kid playing with toys, you know, being a curious kid and starting a fire with your TV. What were some of the repercussions of that event?
Yeah, you know, the book actually begins with the fire. It took place when I was 6 years old. I burned my, my family home down. And yeah, I think, you know, the story to follow puts you into the mind of the story is told in the spirit of the phoenix. So I think I very much emerged, you know, from the flame. So it begins with the fire, even though that wasn't my first traumatic experience. Even at that young age, it was it was a watershed moment in that way, and it was a moment. It was my earliest memory of a time after which things would never be the same. You know, talk about just curiosity, right, of a child, and the tremendous amount of grace and wisdom that it took my mother, you know, for her to extend and not come home, you know, after having lost everything and sort of, you know, lose it. Her main concern was that no one had been hurt. And, you know, I wasn't reprimanded. I wasn't punished in the way that I'd expected to be. And I think there's beauty and there was great value in that. And my mother sort of recognizing that it was my curiosity and it was my imagination that led to the event. So she was able to help me to encourage me to lean into that curiosity and into that imagination by getting into the arts.
So what did that do to your mom, you think? I mean, because she had worked so hard to your father had been murdered earlier, and she was raising you too, and she's built all these things, she's saved up, she's kind of built something normal for the two of you, as normal as can be, and then to literally see it go up in smoke, what does that do to her psyche? What did you find out over time?
It really, I mean, over time, I came to realize just the tremendous amount of strength and you know, resilience that she had. Because you think back, you know, when she lost my father was very young. He was, you know, maybe 26. My mother was still very young. When you at the time, there's no way that she could have fully recovered, because I think maybe, you know, maybe 4 years or so had passed, if that. So you know, she was, the whole family was still very much in the grieving process. Yeah. You know, so this was sort of, back-to-back loss in that way that, yeah, I mean, you know, it should have and could have, been devastating, but it wasn't in many ways.
So who were the men that you looked at as role models or father figures during this impressionable time?
My earliest examples of manhood aside from, what I saw in my grandparents, like in my, my father's father, who I saw, rarely, and in my mother's stepfather, who I referred to as my grandfather, they were sort of the examples. But then there were, the gentlemen that were in my mother's life. So the people that my mother would date, my mother's male friends, a colorful cast of characters, set many an example. Some were good examples, some were bad, but yeah, that was sort of what I had. And I had, again, my older brother, who for all intents and purposes was away from the family because he spent, he essentially came to adulthood in the juvenile justice system. And then, you graduated.
Your mom figured out somehow that your curiosity also translated into the ability for you to express yourself artistically. And she pushed you into that. How did she do that?
I think the earliest indication of, her sort of understanding that that thing, that dynamic was, just in her encouraging me to take art classes, I think in the summer. Well, even before I took visual art classes, my mother, she like signed me up for choir, and she'd always encourage me to sort of lean into music. But when she found out that visual art was sort of my thing, then she was really, really just super supportive of that. And she, at every turn, she would register me for a thing. Anything that was free, I was definitely gonna do. But all the other things that anything we could afford or save up for, she also would encourage.
You also are, very vulnerable in this book, and you write about some very painful moments. In terms of your mom, you basically have kind of a scene that you play out, and it's to try to essentially rescue her from what would be a crack house. What was that like?
I mean, I think about low points of my life, dark moments. I don't know that I've ever been as resigned, as just sad and down, bad as I was in that moment. And it's something that I think I've grappled with over the years. But yeah, in that moment, I went to go and we've been looking for my mom for a period of days. A couple of days had gone by, and I tracked her down, and she was in a drug house. And I thought I was the showing up like the Calvary. I was there to, to save my mom, take her out of this place. And, it was the heart. I had to accept the harsh reality of just, the matter of fact that she, in that moment, preferred to remain, right? She didn't want to leave. So I couldn't convince her to leave. And it was, it was just a super gut-wrenching moment for me as a young person, because I was, as I recall, I was 14, 13 or 14 years old.
Later in the book, you're not living with your mom. You're someplace else. How did you find out that your mother was dead?
Yeah. My mother was murdered when I was, I think I just turned 16 or somewhere between 15 and 16. My mother was murdered. I moved out of the city of Philadelphia to Michigan, to Southfield, Michigan, right outside Detroit, to stay with an uncle, with one of my father's brothers who I never met, just because the streets had gotten so crazy. My neighborhood was crazy. Lots of my friends were, being murdered or, sent to prison. And it was, it was the middle of 1980s drug crack epidemic in everything that sort of came along with it. So my family had sent me to Michigan for a while, and it didn't work out in Michigan. But when I came back to Philly, it was we'd agreed that I wouldn't return to my old neighborhood. So no, I wasn't living with my mother. I was staying in an apartment that my grandparents owned. She was sort of living her life, and I was living mine. I had school, I had work, and days, sometimes weeks, would go by without us seeing one another. But we would speak on the phone, and I just remember there was a period during which a few days had gone by when no one in the family had heard from or seen my mother, which also, again, wasn't out of the norm, right? And over a period of days through that process of elimination, my mother was identified as a Jane Doe who had turned up in the morgue. So yeah, and the way I found out, I mean, it was, I don't know. I think my whole family you know, even by that point had become a bit numb to just experiences that would otherwise be, you know, life-shattering, traumatic experience for other people. We were just so used to loss and grief that I don't know that they pulled any punches. I don't know that. I think, you know, my aunt and my grandmother, so, you know, my grandmother and her sister just confirmed with me that the body, the Jane Doe that had been, you know, found, that we suspected was my mother. Yes, that was Cassie, you know. And you know, we just started to move forward with the arrangements. You know, it was it's wild. I don't remember having shed a tear during my mother's death until I saw her body being lowered into the ground.
At that time, you're also at a creative arts high school, the Philadelphia High School for Creative and Performing Arts, CAPA, right? And we know who they are now, but who was in that high school at the time that was, I guess, your competition, your classmates, your peers that were also performers that went on to be more successful?
I went to that school, which was sort of Philadelphia's version of LaGuardia in New York City, or, you know, like Fame. It was like Fame of the TV series and the film. I was a visual arts major, but there were just very many singers and instrumentalists there who were already, you know, forces to be reckoned with in their own right. So Questlove, who, you know, he and I met there and started the Roots, but there was also Boyz II Men, who before they even came together as Boyz II Men were parts of, you know, other male ensembles who, you know, just beautiful, you know, harmonies. And, you know, so it was walking through the halls of that school made me feel the way it must have felt to, you know, like in the days of Corner Boy doo-wop band. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? They would be, you at any given moment, someone will break out into song, and you'll turn a corner and there'd be Wanye and Nate, you know, working on a harmony. So there was that. And it was a huge confidence builder for me, you know what I mean, to see kids that I knew, you know, doing, like, going on, you know, to the onward and upward.
So how did you and Amir Questlove find each other?
Questlove and I found each other in the principal's office, where we were... Yeah, you know, it probably wasn't the first time we, you know, were in the space together, but we were like two ships, you know, passing each other at sea in the night, usually. And it was in this instance, I think I was on my way out on a suspension, which, you know, I got suspended sometimes. So I was I'd done something, and I was being suspended from school. So I was in the office, and Quest walked in. I think he was bringing like flowers and apples to the faculty, and he had on a jacket, a hand painted denim jacket, which was, you know, one of my side hustles at the time. Was I would do hand painted denim, like, you know, jeans and jackets, and I would sell them, you know, out of my locker. So the jacket that he wore that day, And I think maybe his necklace too that he had on was sort of the gateway to a dynamic that will grow, where, you know, I was able to put him on to parts of elements of the culture and, you know, hip hop music that he hadn't been exposed to yet, and vice versa. And, you know, we became an odd couple, and we remain as such. I think, you know, maybe both of us, you know, just had a desire to, you know, for brotherhood, to experience that brotherhood, because even though I had a brother, I still hadn't really experienced that dynamic in the way that, you know, other siblings had. So it was great, yeah, to have a brother at that time. And then our relationship evolved into something else when it became a business relationship, and it evolved into now what is a marriage. So we went from brotherhood to marriage.
So I wonder, you formed this group. At the time, it wasn't called The Roots, right? What was it called?
Before we were called The Roots, we were called Square Roots.
That's right. So Square Roots. And I wonder, the Square Roots, in the type of influences that were mixing to make the type of music that you wanted to make, and put that in the context of what was happening at the time. Because what we see of The Roots now, which is a mix of so many different influences, is not what was kind of playing on the streets and the car stereos as you were growing up and this group was starting. Knocked up 9 months ago, and what she finna have, she don't know.
She want neo soul, cause hip hop is old. She don't want no rock and roll. Yeah, I think, you know, it was a huge challenge, because not only did we not, you know, we didn't have the same, you know, aesthetic as our contemporaries at the time, nor did we sound or feel, nor did like our music sound or feel like theirs. So, you know, in a mixtape, mixed radio show era, the roots of music sort of stood out like a sore thumb. And it's wild that, you know, it stood out in its musicality, you know, because it was live instrumentation and it just didn't feel like, you know, the standard at that time, it just felt more electronic. And, you know, we had to fight to represent those influences, right? In order to, you know, to expand sort of the palette of the culture, you know? And it's something that, you know, I mean, it's taken some time, but I think over time, the roots has, you know, been hugely responsible for reestablishing that standard. And, you know, now you see, you know, folks who go out to tour, to do gigs, studio sessions, you rarely see, I mean, even within the realm of hip hop, people who don't use live instrumentation.
Is there, you have been in so many different formats. You write about the fact that you were a graffiti artist. At the time, that could be considered vandalism, depending on who saw your work, right? You've done visual arts. You've been rhyming for decades. Here you are writing a book. I mean, what is it about self-expression that keeps you wanting to try it in another format?
It's the challenge of taking on a new sort of format, working in a new medium, of allowing, you know, one discipline to inform another. It keeps me engaged. And, you know, I always meet, you know, folks, sometimes it's one person, sometimes it's 10, sometimes it's more. But, you know, if there's one person that, you know, my work, my story has resonated with in a way that, you know, has, you know, given them any deeper insight into themselves or into their story, then it's worth it. You know what I mean? And that is, you know, it's a two-sided therapy, right? Like this is the work, the process is cathartic for me in that way. So, I just keep, you know, accepting new challenges because there's nothing that, you know, I mean, there's so many people that I've seen come from Philadelphia, and try a thing and win. And those who have won, though, all those many people who I'm able to list who have won, they have won because they didn't give up. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, you know, I feel like any challenge that I take on, as long as I stick to it, I'm going to be able to see it through to fruition.
The book is called The Upcycled Self, a memoir on the art of becoming who we are. Author Tariq Trotter, also known as Black Thought from the Roots. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. This has been awesome. Thank you so much.